brought to you by Express Care Health and Skin Center. Get in, get out, get better.
We are talking about getting a good night's sleep, but for some of you who may suffer from snoring, sleepwalking, or even night terrors, and the people around you, you know, they have to deal with that too. Dr. Yikalam is here from Express Care U, the principal physician, and we are going to tackle some very serious topics. You ready?
I'm ready.
All right, these are serious. And number one, this comes from a couple, Dr. Lam, and they ask, my four-year-old still sleeps with us at night. How can I get her used to sleeping in her own bed? Separation anxiety, maybe.
Yes, that's a tough one, especially because she's already four. So, you know, from infancy, we try to get the kids to get out of the beds, you know, so that they sleep on their own and get used to that. But since your child is already four, you might just start shifting, put a little mattress beside your bed, have the child, you know, move to that and move it further and further away. You can do that. You can put a reward system in place where there's something special in their own room that they can have if they sleep in that room, or a reward the following day if you find them in their room. Or sometimes letting them fall asleep in your own bed and then shifting them during the night. That is another way, common way that people gradually get over that. No, there's no doubt about it. By the time your child is a teenager, she will not be in your bed, so it'll be okay eventually.
Well, the cool kids these days call that gamification, offering badges and rewards for, you know, a job well done. So good advice. All right, number two, what is the difference, Dr. Yikalam, between nightmares and night terrors?
Oh, okay. Yeah, they kind of seem similar, right? Night terrors occur in children that are usually under the age of five, young children, who actually have an awake experience. They look like they're awake, their eyes are open, but they're not conscious, they're not able to interact with you because they're having an intense dream, but they look like they're awake. So they might be screaming, they might be seeing monsters, they might be walking, they might be basically having a very intense experience that you can't relate to, that is really terrifying to everybody, like you said, parents and the child. And eventually that experience will end and the child will go back to bed and probably have no memory of that at all. And a nightmare is different because you're asleep the whole time. You're not up and looking at people or doing anything. You're just asleep and wake up in the morning with the memory of a dream. So night terror you usually don't remember, nightmare you do.
Any credence to the myth that if you eat later on at night, you'll have nightmares?
Some people do, and also some people, it's the type of food they're eating, they might get a nightmare from it. Yeah, that's possible.
I've got the weirdest dreams when I eat lasagna at 1 a.m.
There you
go. So I certainly attest to that. All right, question number three. My two-year-old's loud snoring and gasping spells keep us up at night, another couple. Is this a phase or should we be worried?
No, I think you really should be worried. If your child is two and they're gasping and snoring, they probably do suffer from sleep apnea. And as we mentioned earlier, young children can have that because their adenoids and tonsils can be swollen from allergies. And this is an indication sometimes for a tonsillectomy or an adenoidectomy, basically removing those bumps like you mentioned earlier so that the airflow is less turbulent and the child can sleep better. And why do we care if children sleep? Well, because they need to sleep in order to rest, in order to learn, in order to grow, and in order to not be obese. Because if you're constantly waking up all night long, you're gasping for air, you can't breathe properly, it does affect both your heart, your lungs, and your ability to learn.
Is there any problems that kids could experience from maybe choking on like postnasal drip or on air even?
They can what we call aspirate, meaning that basically some acid and contents of the stomach sort of come up, kind of like vomiting, but not quite as coming out, going back in.
Right.
And they can be prone to pneumonia and stuff like that, usually younger child.
All right, very, very serious topic. The next question, this would be number four. My child has a hard time sleeping at night, Dr. Lam. Is there anything I can do to make him sleepy? Ease into it, or just, is it one of those, you better go to sleep, boy.
Yeah. That never works. Yeah.
They'll stay up despite you.
They will. But sometimes children can't go to sleep because they have a lot of anxiety. They're afraid of the dark. They're afraid of something they're not even telling you about. A test tomorrow or a bully at school or who knows what. Sometimes they won't tell you or they don't even know. Other times it's because of what they've been up to. So trying to make bedtime very boring. So let's say you want your child to go to bed at 8. Boring needs to start at about 6:30. So let's say you eat before that. Then there's something, you know, some after activity that's kind of calming down, maybe a bath or story time, something like that. And then don't do watching TV before bed, because between the screen and the activity and the interesting things that they'll see on TV, it's stimulating to the brain. So we want to do something really boring, like play a quiet game, or you know, even take a walk with your children if you're able to do that. But you just want to make the evening activities very quiet. And if you get your child to do an after-school activity that's a sport, or even if you can't do that, at least have them run around outside, play with their game, with their friends, kick a ball around, some physical activity, they'll be more tired and ready to go to sleep. Okay. You can also do some hot milk before bed or chamomile tea. And you can buy a supplement over the counter that's safe for children. It's called valerian root. It's very safe, and they can take that as well before bed.
I've heard about that, and I've heard very, very good things.
It helps. It, yeah.
High degree of effectiveness, apparently. Okay, last question, and I can identify with this. Certainly the teenage me could. I have a sleepwalking disorder. Will that mean my son will likely suffer from the disorder too? Are sleepwalking conditions genetic?
I don't think they're genetic, but maybe people are more predisposed to them in families. I don't think there's a direct link. Like, you would for sure have a son that sleepwalks. It might run in your family. Might be more common.
Mm-hmm. Any chance on what causes sleepwalking at all?
Or? Oh well, sleepwalking. We were talking about the night terrors. You're having again an experience where you're unconscious, but you're in a level of sleep that allows you to actually move your body in a coordinated way and walking mm-hmm. around. So you're sort of functioning in a different level of consciousness when you're sleepwalking.
Okay, well, Dr. Lampe, we didn't get a chance to get to spontaneous combustion, which I wanted to talk about, but that's a completely different, maybe next week.
Next week.
Okay, well, thanks so much again.
Thanks.